All right, we're going to move on to the next part of our agenda. Our Zoetis discussion panel, Maximizing Your Herd's Genetics, an Essential Strategy for Today's Dairy Farmer. Our panel guests joining us today, and as I call your name, if you could come on up and grab a comfy chair. The guy's got it all warmed up for you. Ian Crosbie, Benbie Holsteins, producer from Saskatchewan. So, Ian, I am a Saskatchewan girl hailing in Regina, and we have lots of snow at home this morning, so I've been thankful to be out here. Adam Zehr from Walnutlawn Farms, producer from Ontario. Adam, come on up. Jodi Wallace, Silverstream Holsteins, producer and vet, Ormstown vet from Quebec. Jodi, thank you for joining us. Come on up. Nick Bokma, Bokma Farms, producer from Nova Scotia. Come on up. Have we got everybody? There we go. Nick, welcome. And now, if we could please bring up Dr. Anthony McNeel, who is going to moderate this event for us. Thank you. Dr. Anthony McNeel is a principal scientist with Zoetis Precision Animal Health, and he has been a member of the Precision Animal Health Technical Service Team since July of 2015. Currently based out of Kalamazoo, Michigan? Michigan? Thank you. Dr. McNeel is originally from the Pacific Northwest region of the United States, where his family managed both beef and dairy cattle. Dr. McNeel earned his PhD in animal science with an emphasis on reproductive physiology from Oregon State University in 2010. And during his graduate work, Dr. McNeel focused on bovine reproduction, molecular biology, and assisted reproductive technologies. You had no fun in school. You were studying lots. After obtaining his PhD, Dr. McNeel was a postdoctoral research associate at the USDA ARS US Meat Animal Research Center in Clay Center, Nebraska. Yeah, you've had no fun. While at US Mark, Dr. McNeel gained experience in genomics, bioinformatics, computer programming, and relational database. Dr. McNeel's training and experiences in production, physiology, and genomics provide him with the flexibility to help producers of varying levels of understanding and production goals. Dr. Anthony McNeel, it's now your turn.
Thank you for that very warm introduction. Welcome, folks, and I hope you're ready for a good discussion. We've been talking for the last couple months, getting to know each other, and that culminated last night at the pub. And we're just trying to replicate that experience and sharing these producers' experiences and journeys with the Holstein Canada portfolio of services, and really starting with registration, classification, and then most recently with clarified testing, so genomic testing, and specifically how they've incorporated that technology into their operations. So you probably know these folks a lot better than you know myself, even after that drawn-out introduction. And I'm really just here to kind of get them started, and because they have a lot of good experiences, and really just hoping you guys can share those experiences with the audience today. And to that point, so Adam and Jodi, you guys have both had success in terms of breeding bulls. You have put some bulls into stud, and that takes a fair amount of patience, perseverance, and a little bit of luck. Can you guys share with us how you accomplished that, and really how Clarified has helped you achieve that goal?
That's a great question. Are these on? Hi. I guess it was way back in 2014. It's old news. We did that, but we genomic tested the whole herd at the time, and you find an outlier, and once you find an outlier, then you get a phone call, and then the phone call makes a bull contract, and you get flush a heifer, and we have a bunch of bulls and heifers, and we just got lucky enough to put a couple in the unit, and one of their bulls, Silverstream Porter, we got lucky. He's actually went to Proven Bull, and I think just the last two times he's not been on the list, but he went up to number two LPI in the country. So did we do a lot of work for that? Well, maybe, but we got lucky, I guess, too. And it was out of a herd we bought. We bought Templedale Holsteins, and it was a cow we bought at the time. So good cow families.
Yeah, that luck is still a fairly large component, right? With 1.15 quintillion possible combinations from any given mating, you got to see what the DNA gave you, really.
Yeah, and going back to what you were mentioning about the families, I guess for me, it's the base of it all is good cow families. And so when I guess it was 10, 15 years ago, I kind of decided I want to put some bulls in the stud. And my parents allowed me to kind of go out and make some purchases and investments in cows that were from what we thought were the best cow families and the best cows from those families. And for me, it's like make no exception, the very best you can. And we've just tried to continue that. And from our very first cow that we bought, kind of more with geared toward genomics, numbers, base, was Misty Springs Lavengard Sioux. And she's a cow that holds a special spot in my heart, I think, because she was the first one. She's probably the best transmitter we ever worked with. And for me, early on with genomics, I've really had a belief, and the longer we're doing it, the longer we go, the more experience I've got, the more I believe it's those bulls and the females that are a big deviation above their parent average, that are the ones that are the real extreme against outliers, that those are the ones that really have the ability to turn out those next generation of really extreme sires or bull mothers, whatever it is. So that still is something that I look at when selecting bulls or in my own herd for females, whether I deem a female good enough to flush to hopefully get a bull into stud, its deviation over parent average. And especially for the major traits. For me, that's type. It's also, I know I got out of production, but for me, I look a little heavier towards fat kilos, fat percentage than I do milk, as I see that's the most profitable. So for those things, I definitely like to see a deviation over parent average because I trust the science. So it's kind of what we've done.
Yeah, and to those points, right, that came out in discussions last night, focusing still a bit on confirmation, and that's what works for you, right? So do you think you've really changed your strategy, or do you think you're maybe making fewer mistakes with using genomic information?
Definitely haven't changed the strategy. I still consider myself a type breeder. I like the health traits and all those other things too, but deep inside I'm a type breeder is what I feel like our aim is, and even when breeding bulls, I believe in making matings that I'm going to want females from, not just because somebody at the stud said this would be a good bull to cross on this one. It's a mating that I believe in, and I think those are the best bulls. And I guess for our farm, I hope we can make a brand that we're known to have some type bulls. We've had a few bulls that have been number one type, and I hope we can continue that and get production and some of those other things in there as well. It's hard to get it all, but do your best.
Nick, you were nodding along pretty well there. Do you want to add something?
No, just like I see a lot of similarities. You know, we at our farm, we haven't put bulls in a stud, but we've done the same thing Adam's done when I came onto the farm. You know, we had an emphasis on we always use good bulls, but as soon as I kind of took over the breeding program, I've sought out after high females to add to our program out of good cow families. We started with that, and we flushed them. We drive production, and you know, like over the years we've added, you know, elite heifers, and we've got our herd that's come a long way over the past 10 years. And you know, when we're in a robot barn now, but in our freestyle barn, you know, we selected these high females on their genomics solely, and you know, flushed them, and now we've taken our production from, you know, mid-30s, and now we're into the mid-40s, right? Just over adding those good families with their genetic profiles and using, you know, high bulls that we like, that fit our, you know, that fit our profile at our farm, what we want to do. And you know, you accelerate genetic growth at a rapid rate. So yeah, but maybe not on the bull side like these two guys. And Ian's put he's the bull guy too, so he definitely should get
he's got a special Ian, one coming up here too.
Yeah, Ian's,
a special bull
Ian's
coming along.
Yeah, and I get a royalty on him too, so please buy him when he comes out. My lead, I guess, into using the service of genomic tests and everything started out a little different. Like, to be quite honest, it was I hated pulling hairs off of animals. And we'd ran out of tags with Holstein Canada, so I looked at it as with using the tissue samples. Well, it's a lot easier to do that, and I've wasted money on a lot dumber things on the farm than taking a DNA sample off of the animal. So that's quite bluntly how we got started with doing it. But we noticed some results right off the bat that it paid off right away. And any of these animals that, going back to what Adam was saying originally, like the ones that jump out at you as being an outlier and well above parent average are the ones that were, like, we noticed it once they entered the milking herd. The second animal that we ever tested once we got onto it all, she jumped out right away. As I think she came out, she was like 16 for type or something like that. She was a high octane who was just grand champion at Red Deer Show there last fall and is 95 points. So right off the bat, we could tell it made a difference on these high-end ones. And since then, too, the bulls that we've put into stud now, it's all gone back to animals that jumped off the page, that there was something different to them, so it was worth working with them. Doing a little bit of conventional flushing, IVF, and then even sex semen just within the cow family to try and get them into the herd more and really work with our top-end genetics. And I guess the other big side of it on our end is utilizing the beef semen that goes with it. We have our own brand of beef, Saskatchewan Snow Beef, that's sold in the province. That's a Wagyu Holstein cross. And so after I got started with DNA tests and everything, I was really utilizing it to differentiate who was getting beef semen, who we were using to make that next generation of replacement females. And so far, it's worked out pretty good on both ends.
I think all four of you have done ET at some stage, right? Like, it's been part of your program. And Adam, you highlighted it, right? There's the animals that you're really looking for, those outliers, those ones that go above a bit above parent average. Have any of you seen that, we call it variation, right? Those differences, have you seen them narrow? Or is it that's still there even after multiple generations?
We don't have access to direct genomic values anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah, would be handy.
We can still add up. Like I like the direct genomic values as well. We talked about that last night. I think we all do. But you still can add up where the parent average is at. And I think it's those lines, and you continue from your highest outlier, you know, and then she gets whatever many daughters, you continue with that line. And that's the line that seems to continue to be able to do that and put those higher ones out. And to me, that's just the science of genomics showing you the best line. It's there. It tells you what they've got, what they don't, in my opinion. So.
Well, that's what we said last night, that genomics just adds science to the art of cattle breeding. You still have to have that art, know cow families, know how it's going to cross, and some of it's just a guess, too.
And having a plan, right? All four of you have very well-articulated plans. And that's one of the things I've seen with producers when they start, and they'll just start testing. And then they'll get a call from, well, I'll get a call from them, be like, I don't trust genomics. Like, how are you using it? What do you mean using it? You have to use it to see value in the technology. I think Ian, your experience with snow beef is a really good example. Do you think you'd be as aggressive with that beef F1? If you didn't have the genomic results?
I might look at it a little differently. Like, honestly, my, I guess, perspective on it all has changed a little bit, because when I first started, it was, you know, I made like a threshold of my LPI cutoff, or, you know, maybe if they were maybe a higher type, when I would allow them to be bred Holstein and that. But I've kind of changed my attitude on that still a little bit, just because it isn't a perfect science for sure. The outliers are the ones that jump out. I'm making sure I'm working with those, whether they're getting sex semen or I'm flushing them to work with them a little bit. But those ones that kind of fall in the in-betweener, I'm still wanting to wait and see what they actually do as far as once they get into production, how much I really like them. Because I've had it a few times where in the beef tags are right in there, you know, what the dam, the cross is, and you're going through like, oh, probably should have, you know, had that one Holstein. She was a better cow than what I originally had just by looking at the number. And then there's some of the Holsteins at Cavan, and too, it's like, oh, why did you get bred to Holstein there? So the in-betweeners, I think I still want to see what they do when they get into production, which is why there's still the value in classification and milk recording. I mean, once they're a two-year-old and you fully know what you're getting out of that animal, the DNA, the genomics is a very good insight. And it kind of is your first line of separation on your animals. But I still like to prove them out to know exactly what I'm doing with those animals.
Yeah, I think that's a pretty common strategy, right? The DNA is the starting point. And then as we start to get more information, be it from classification or DHI test, they just layer it on top. And I think, was it you, Nick, that had the spreadsheet that we were talking about last night?
Well, my brother and I, like I believe the same thing as Ian. Like beef is a great tool to promote propelling your genetic growth too. And we have a spreadsheet on our farm that we like to use where we take, from our milking herd, we take cows on their BSA milk, their BSA fat, we have protein in there along with their classification scores and their robot performance. So how fast they milk out and their attachment rate. So we allot, 20% for their milk component, 30% of their score goes to fat, and then the robotic attachment rates and flow are combined 25%, and their classification score combines the last 25%. They throw all those together in their herd rankings, and they're spit out with our Bokma Farms index. And from there, we breed, we want 12, 14 heifer calves a month, right? And we don't want to grow any more because, it costs money to rear replacements. And so we use that as a tool to say, this is how we're going to get our 12, 14 heifer calves a month. We're going to breed the top 80 of our milk cow, our milking herd, 80 to 100, and we're going to get heifer calves from them. Those are our top producers, our highest scored cows. We believe in the Holstein Canada classification model where it's going to, that's going to be longevity and higher scored cattle. We like working with beautiful cattle too. That's not a secret either. But with, the profitability from the milk and the fat and the timing of connectivity and the robots, it just leads to overall profitability. And then use of beef semen, we take out any guesswork of who's the middle ground, and they're all bred beef, terminal crosses. And then we work with, half of our virgin heifers, and we breed them to all sex semen and beef. And that's allowed us to, carry, like I said before, we've always pushed 1.4, 1.5 kgs of fat, and, we've hit 2 kgs of fat per cow. So, and we kind of hang around there, maybe a little bit lower. So, yeah, definitely and then the genomics on those cows have produced some of our best heifers, and we've flushed them. And like I said, our ET program has allowed us to have some really cool 2-year-olds. And we've seen that in the classification scores, working with those high-end cattle that were, our classification scores are on the rise too. So it's been a cool tool to use, and we're seeing it coming out in our herd too. So.
Yeah, it sounds like it's had a really good journey for you guys. Mm-hmm. And you highlight that one point in there about generating just enough heifers, right? You know it's expensive to raise those heifers, and you want to keep that cost of production down. And you see Adam's sitting there nodding his head, probably wants to get in on this as well. But Jodi, you'd mentioned a couple times about having to have a good calf program. And that's something I've run into internationally, right? So I work in the US, I work in Canada, Australia, New Zealand, South Africa, Saudi Arabia. If there's not a good calf program, genomics is like limited. So would you mind kind of expanding on your views on the calf program and its importance in your breeding program?
So I guess for some of you who don't know, I do a lot of calf work, calf consulting, and we push 0-0 calf care at home at Anderson Farms, where we can go with 0 treatments and 0 deaths, and we can do that up to 4 years. That was, I guess, our record straight. So to say that it's doable and things are limitless and how good we can make calf care, and we're living in the past for calf care, and we got to do better. And as a vet too, we start genomics and we're doing genomic testing. I don't even start, maybe I'll start, we're going to do genomic testing, but we're going to review your colostrum program, because why waste money on dropping the best calves and we can't keep them healthy, or we're treating for pneumonia, or we're going to lose them. So it's a big deal. And then at home, so we go to genomics, sex semen, now we have all these calves, and now everybody's staying alive. And then now not that we lost them before, but then you get an issue of overcrowding. Yep. So then genomics comes in again, full scale. Well, we're going to test and call again, because the bottom is going to go. So there's a nice, takes a lot, because we're going to, if you want to maximize the genetics, you got to maximize that transition cow period in that first 24 hours. All the studies show if you do that passive transfer and get the colostrum in the right stuff, then they're going to realize their full potential. And we talk about epigenetics, and that's a whole other field. But I can't emphasize enough the importance of transition cows and calf raising just to get there. And then we're going to get more milk on top of just the genetics. I think it's all those things combined. But like I said, we need a plan going forward for that.
Yeah, and those older cows, and they're mature, right? They're going to produce more milk. Like when you control for genetics, an older cow is going to produce more milk regardless. I'm going to pause now because I can see Adam just ready to comment.
No, I actually wasn't. I was just agreeing. I was just agreeing with this. This is good. To comment on the beef, with the beef semen, I guess we talked about this last night as well, how, like, I understand, depending, everybody has different situations, and for us, I don't have as many cows and available uteruses, I guess, to put it that way, for recipients, as some of these do. Like, I only milk 70 cows, and so for me, I still prefer doing a lot of genomic tests and sorting, especially the top ones out for who's going to be our embryo donors. And then I kind of move down through, and a lot of my virgin heifers are used for recipients. So for us, there's the odd time I'll use beef semen, but it's pretty rare, just because I need to have heifers just coming through so I can keep enough embryos going in, as I already don't have a ton of embryos going in because I don't have a lot of recipients around. So for us, it's a little bit different. And I understand both ways, you know, whatever works for each individual farm. And I think that's where, for anybody in this room or anybody listening, that, like, do what works for you. It's pretty, you know, it's not going to be the same on every farm. And if it works for you, it works for you, and run with it. There's a lot of possibilities with genomic testing. I think last night, hopefully I'm not skipping ahead with this too much, Tony, but Tony, you had a great analogy last night about predicting who's going to make the playoffs.
Oh, yeah.
And I think you should share that about genomics. I think this is a good, it's a really good analogy to talk about the advantage we have.
Yeah, so aside from I didn't have a lot of fun. Is that in grad school and in my postdoc, right? I was.
Tony knows how to have fun. We saw that.
Yeah, I was a bit of a glutton for punishment. I like to learn, which is a good and a bad thing. So my role, right, is it's a bit of an eclectic role in Zoetis. I'm a translational scientist. So it means I talk to producers day in and day out. I have to keep up with some pretty sharp people. They're geneticists in Zoetis. And then I have to find the in-between. So a lot of what I do is on analogies. And so when explaining what genomics is or what reliability is, right, it's how much confidence we have in the prediction. And for the hockey analogy, right, would you rather try to predict who's going to make the playoffs on the first day of the season or with three games to go? And that's what genomics is helping us do. It's basically saying, okay, you have a lot of information, a season's worth of information, and now you just need to pick who's going to make the playoffs with three games to go.
Unless you're a Leaf fan, then you think you can predict her the first day.
That's a different discussion. They get there. They get to the playoffs.
They're also out the first round.
Yeah, and it's good information. It helps us take better decisions. It's not going to be perfect, right? It's just accurate. It gives us more accurate decisions so that the decisions we're taking on farm in terms of who to flush, who's going to get beef semen, who's going to give us that nice Wagyu on Holstein Cross, we can have more confidence in those decisions.
I think it's going to, like, commercially, it's going to slowly take over. It might still be another 5-10 years before the bigger guys really grasp onto it. But my in-laws, they milk 1,200 cows a few hours away from me. And so my father-in-law, John, he'd be up here probably disagreeing with us all, but I'll wait for the day when he'll finally admit, okay, we're going to start testing, because his motto right now is always, well, good is good enough. And so whether it's choosing bulls is kind of middle of the road, and how they're going about their breeding program, is just everything middle of the road is just good is good enough. But they've been in expansion mode like crazy for the last 10 years too. And so once that slows down, whether it's a limiting factor on getting your hands on quota, land, whatever it may be, our margins are always still going to keep getting tighter and tighter, and eventually you're going to have to look at your genetic side of, because, I mean, even coming to nutrition, it's changed so much over the last 15, 20 years that eventually your limiting factor might come down to your genetics. And I see it firsthand out in Saskatchewan all the time. There's some really well-managed Hutterite colonies that are in the province, but you never, ever see them in the top production of the herds. They might make it into the top management because they're good at getting cows and calf or what it may be, but they cannot get the milk out of those cows. And it's strictly they are being held back because they need to use their jumper bulls. Because up until now, there's a few of them using AI now, but it was all strictly natural breeding, and it's held them back significantly. And even on the pig side, which is why they're now allowed to AI, they were starting to lose contracts with Cargill and that because they had fallen so far behind in their genetic progress. And that was just on AI. So the next wave of that going to be, I think, will be the genomic side when the commercial producer finds the value in it, and making sure that calf that he's spending probably $3,500, $4,000 to raise is a good one. It costs the same to raise a good one as it does a bad one. So what's the point of raising that disappointment?
You stole the words. I was just going to say the same thing, like what Jodi says about, you know, the calf care and about keeping, you know, you have all these calves that are alive, and like we've chosen to keep our numbers down because of, you know, they do well when they're not, when there's so much, you know, with the crowded, the overcrowding. And then what you said, like, there's a lot of smart farmers out there that make good forages and that are great managers of their cows. And you can do all those things right. And then I think that genetics is that thing where it gives your cows an extra level to go, right? And that's what people, I don't think, if they understand genetics or genomics, that they can't tap into. Like, you know, there's a lot of keen farmers out there, great managers. Genetics and using the genomics in a progressive way is just going to allow you to give those animals the ceiling to do more, right? So,
yeah, for me, that's been pretty clear the last, three, 4 years. I don't know if probably a few people in the room know, but maybe not everybody. We were in a tie stall barn up until 3 years ago. We moved into a new robot barn with a couple Lely A5s, and we're milking 70 cows on two robots, and they have lots of room. And just seeing the difference that we've seen in production in our herd, like our herd's gone up from approximately a 35 to 37 liter average to 43 now. And we really see it in our best cows. Our best cows went from here to here, where our, you know, the middle of the road cows, they went up a little bit, but they didn't take the same jump. And it's because we've improved our comfort. We've improved our feeding. Our precision in feeding is way better than it used to be. I think with our bunks, we're putting in better forages. We were in tower silos, and now we're a custom bunk where we get the feed in a little better timing. Everything just a little more precise. And then those cows, then when we've upped our management, our best cows, our best genetic cows, have given us a much bigger bump than the middle of the road or bottom end, and it's definitely separated the best from the average to the poor. So,
yeah, I mean, it's the foundation, right? Like, when the calf hits the ground, the DNA is fixed. Like, we can't do anything to change it at that point. So that's really the foundation of your operation, because from everything else, you're just building on top of that. You're providing the environment for those cows to succeed. And we see that globally, right? There's a lot of variation in our management. I mean, if it's here in Canada, the U.S., New Zealand, that variation exists. And it's pretty substantial. It's helped folks, especially in COVID, avoid the worst. Like when milk markets tanked, they were like, oh, this sucks. But if they've been testing for a number of years, they were able to kind of withstand the drop pretty well because they controlled their cost of production relatively well. Even quiet, Ian.
That's not usual, actually.
So you keyed in on that point about your father-in-law, right? And he's milking 1,200 head, freestall, right?
Yep.
Right. But he's not genomically testing.
No.
Why do you think that is?
His model right now is good enough. I mean, and my two brothers-in-law. That own the farm with them, and they've been pushing the hyper-aggression on expansion and that, but I think their focus is just so much on, there's so many other areas where they can look at trying to make a profit into their management, be it labor, feed, their cost of feed, everything like that. And I mean, when you're in expansion mode, yeah, you need pretty well every replacement that you can make, but there will come a time, like I said, I don't know whether it's going to be a couple years or 5 years down the road where all of a sudden they're going to realize, like, they're not going to be able to grow anymore. So now it's, okay, well, how do we fine-tune what we've already got going on here? And I think that, because they still classify, they're off of milk recording as of now, but I could see it all coming back when, I mean, they're money-driven. They are, look at the dollars and cents big time. And for what it costs, like I said to begin with, I've spent a lot of money in a lot dumber ways than I have ever, to know what the genetics are of that calf. You know, maybe there is nothing special about it. Maybe there is. You don't know until you test them. And it's that original curiosity that can spark something in you too. And all of a sudden, it doesn't take long to snowball. And you can manipulate your cow family so quick, like Nick, with the sex semen and beef semen now. Like, in 5 years, you can turn your herd upside down in how it looks just by identifying your best animals and breeding from them, and then beef semen for the rest. And that's all we need now. We got to really try and watch every animal space that we're, you see it over in Europe, you see it everywhere right now, as far as you're trying to eliminate get as much production from as few animals as possible, and that's only going to keep being more and more prevalent down the road, I think.
Yeah, it's not fast either, right? I mean, how long does it take before we see the impact of a breeding that we make today? Like, just think about it, right? If it's in the milk stream, it's, what, 32, 35 months before we see that conception enter the milk stream? That's a long time. It's a marathon, effectively, right? I'd be curious to know, when you guys started, what were your parentage errors like? Like, how often did you have an incorrect sire? And it came back, and you got the genomic results, and you had, oh, that's wrong.
Yeah, with me and my dad breeding, there's the odd time there's a phantom breeding get thrown in there once in a while, and the data recorders don't like that too much. So we were probably in that 10% range, maybe, something like that. I was given a lot of grief from my wife about that, too, until I was told that the average of the Canadian dairy farm was a little higher than that, so at least I was a bit below, but more than I would care to have admitted, that's for sure.
Sometimes you're breeding cows to beef and Holstein comes out, so I wonder if that's straw related or I don't know the exact number though, Tony. That's a good question.
Yeah, Adam, do you know?
I've had one, but I've, like I said, I don't have a huge herd, so I don't have. It's pretty rare I have multiple births at one, like during the night or something. So out of all the years, I've only had one that's been wrong.
One, you're lying.
I'm serious.
Yeah, you'll get
manager enough.
Oh, okay.
You mean, but missed tags is different than missed bulls, you mean? Because sometimes a calf at night, but then you just check the cameras and see who's who, right?
Yeah. Potentially, yeah. If she's calving by herself, yeah, especially.
Yeah. No, I've definitely had many, I shouldn't say many. I can't give you the exact number, but definite conversation with the Holstein staff. Yeah, this one's not matching up. And it's usually, you know, you use sex semen, you have three heifer calves in the same pen and three mums looking. And you're like, yeah, so.
Do you have cameras?
We do have, some of them are malfunctioned now, so. Oh. But yeah.
So the statistic globally is 15%. Like, so 15% of recorded or submitted sires are wrong, and that's per generation.
Yeah, that's what I had to tell my wife, that I was better than average still from my misreading on that.
And it's eerie how frequent or how consistent that is. Like, well, we'll go into a new farm and we'll say, hey, you know, on average, 15% of what you have in your computer is wrong. Mm-hmm. Oh, really? I don't believe you. And like 6 months later, it was 17%. So it, on average, it's 15%. And it's here in Canada, in the U.S., U.K. Like, and it's because we're people, right? We've got a lot on our plate. We're trying to manage. We got cows, Kevin, at the same time. Maybe multiple guns in the shirt as we're going out to breed. You make mistakes. I think that's okay. It's just recognizing that those mistakes exist and how are we going to fix it, right? And part of that is genomics. It's getting it fixed, getting the herd book corrected, and now you have better insights in terms of what this animal can potentially do.
So a question for you as Zoetis, I guess. As far as your genomic testing goes and development within your beef breeds, is there any talk of you guys overlapping that within our dairy breed to perhaps have a little bit more insight, because you know it's pretty well known. If the dairy animal is known to have an influence going through the auction mart, you're going to get deducted money from it. Now, if we had a little bit more insight into some of these beef traits to, you know, perhaps get a better ribeye size or whatever it is that they like to knock the dairy on, is there any development coming down the line of that? Because it could be something that might be 10, 15, 20 years down the road. Who knows? But our animals are essentially, I mean, just on the panel here, the amount of beef semen we're using, we're back to a dual purpose breed, and we've made zero ground on any of our beef traits. So either an animal at my place, anyways, either she's going to be feed for the coyotes or she's heading off into the food industry. And is there any kind of line coming down there with our dairy beef genomics coming out, some kind of data?
So like the beef characteristics of a purebred Holstein?
Yes.
If you can find the data, I would be interested. I don't think it exists, unfortunately. Not at scale.
It's all out there, though. We register everything. You got a button tag in them, and they're going to the slaughter plant. You could pull it up.
Yeah, it's the collecting of the carcass data. That's the limiting factor. So the Angus Association in the U.S., they invest a fair amount of money on that. So the beef breeds, the beef breed associations would be the source for that information.
And maybe, is there a way to cross-reference what our dairy breeds are doing with what the data is coming back off the beef breeds?
To a limited extent, but the effects of the DNA are very breed specific, so that's why you have those calibrations. I'm trying not to get too far into the weeds, right? But the value of the DNA changes by breed. So some markers or some pieces of DNA are more important for like a Holstein than they would be for a Jersey, and so we see that in beef as well. So yeah, I really have to have a database of information in order to build that type of information, which right now doesn't exist in the dairy breeds.
But the information's out there. We just got to collect it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, because I just look at it as far as a profitability standpoint down the road that right now we're getting deducted because we have dairy influence on our crossbred beef calves. If you bred for it, we know how quickly things can change, or at least you were aware of it, that you're instead of using two bulls that were very similar, but bull A has way better beef characteristics. You go a few generations along those lines, how long until all of a sudden our crossbred calves are the desirable ones? The guys that are in the feedlots are looking for those because they're going to turn out more AAA, more prime carcasses, and they're actually going to make more value off of having dairy influenced beef versus the traditional ranch cow.
Yeah, it's are you being rewarded for it, right? And we kind of talked about that last night with A2, right? A2's nice, but if you're not getting paid for it, what's the value? So for those dairy animals and them feeding into the food chain, it's really like, okay, are you going to get rewarded for it? And so great, now we'll start developing something for that. But today, like for the next 9 months, 18 months, 36 months, it's probably going to be those crossbreds because that crossbred's worth more even in the feedlot with a dairy influence, than a straight bred Holstein steer is. I think it was Tyson, in the States, they shut down accepting Holstein steers. They said, no more, we can't do it. Because they didn't fit their processing chain. Too big, too long. They just said, no, we're not buying any more Holstein steers.
I had a question for Jodi. I don't know if I can interrupt. I had a
Go
question
ahead.
For Jodi.
Okay.
And you said you have all those extra calves, and have you ever found yourself selling the extra calves? And what kind of criteria are you using to call them out? Are you going on LPI? Are you a pro dollars? Or what's your strategy and for the rest of the guys too?
Well, I guess we did a couple of things. Like we actually sold them in a big batch. We do both. We do the get the list from the genomic testing. You take the bottom 15%. We pick 15 actually. And these are the ones we didn't like on our criteria for milk, cell count, like health traits, mm-hmm. fat. And then we would go out and eyeball them. So we take the genotype and match the phenotype. Mm-hmm. And then most of them match anyway, and then we're going to pull. And actually, we went in St. Hyacinth near Montreal, we just sent them to a dairy sale. We got them all tested for leucosis, neospora, salmonella, all go to a dairy sale. We get just a bit over beef price. Did we get paid enough? No. But at least we can sell 15 at a time, they're gone.
But what was your criteria? Did you like pro dollars? You just did it on the health traits or whatever.
Yeah,
was
pro dollars, milk, fat, health traits, cell score.
Because last night we were looking at the list. Of course, the proofs just came out, and we saw that Silverstream was in the top 100 for pro dollars. So that was pretty. Your strategy must be.
But we're upset because my cull calls didn't leave yesterday, and there's some undone registrations from January that are missing. So they'd be even better. But no, like I worked part-time for Zoetis like way back when too, and when we had clarified and before Pro Dollars is out, we made an index which actually with the clarified is actually almost exactly like Pro Dollars now. So we were doing that in 2012, 2014. So I already had we were 5 years ahead of the curve in that Pro Dollars. So that's why we rank high in Pro Dollars, honestly. And plus we bought a really high LPI herd, Templedale Holsteins at the time. So we kind of lucked out, but just because our indexes match pro dollars. What are you doing right now?
Well, now that we have a tool that helps identify, our cows that we want to work with, we find ourselves with just the right amount. Because we had a point in time where, we sold 50 excess heifers as well, and we did the same thing. We looked at, maternal lines and LPI and profitability of the dams, and we made the best choice with the genomics that we had, right? So, I wonder, and I don't know if we've talked, we didn't really talk about this last night, maybe, but has a sex semen and beef strategy, has it given us, I think it's given us, has it depleted the heifer? I don't know what you guys are seeing in Ontario, but fresh cows were at a premium in Nova Scotia, and there wasn't enough. Maybe people have gone too far with it or not, or what are you guys seeing out there? I mean, I'm taking...
You're doing fine, man. Like, go ahead.
No, I'm just curious because these are conversations we have producers out our way too, right? And like I said, up to you know, replacement costs and stuff like that. You know, just keeping your you know, with obviously a buffer of, you know, if you have a heifer that just doesn't quite cut it one way or the other, you know, temperament wise or, you know, cross teat wise or whatever it be. So
how to find the balance, right? How to find the balance between using too much beef and then having too many replacements.
Yeah. I don't know what the right answer to that is. Like for us, because usually I'm going to have more replacements than I need because we're using them for recipients. And so I have a few, we don't sell like an insane amount of animals. We don't have, like I said, we're not a huge farm, but, for us, usually we have some extras, and there's a few farmers in the area that usually if they need milk, they'll call, and they'll ask what I got. And this past fall, I had two of them tell me they think they've maybe gone a little bit too far with using a beef, and they said now all of a sudden we got given a little bit extra quota, and we're running it so tight that they're out looking for some. So for me, that's a good thing. Now, I don't know if the price has gone high enough that they might still be sitting just fine. I'm not saying they're not. But I've taken note that this past fall was the first time since the beef and sex semen things come along that I've heard that. Mm-hmm. Whether it's being said a lot, I don't know. But I think there's a little bit of, there could be something to it. I don't know.
Yeah, I think probably did go overboard a little bit. Probably we overcorrected too much of the flood that we have from, you know, it was only, what, 10 years ago where sex semen actually was good enough that you could utilize it in your milking herd and you were getting good enough conception from it that you could confidently go out and do what Nick's doing with just using sex and beef semen only. And so there probably was a correction in the market for that because everyone, you know, I mean, fresh heifers there wasn't long ago, they were worth $1,800. I've always viewed it as, you know, on a 10-year rolling average though, for what the price of a fresh cow is, it might be a bit of a bullish market right now, but the average price that you're going to get for that replacement heifer or two-year-old is going to be less than what you paid to raise her. And so I'm always, we haven't sold a group of replacements in 5 years, I don't think. And like right now we're at a point where we actually do have a few more fresh two-year-olds calving in. Luckily enough, the cull price is also sitting there right around $1 a pound. And so right now at home, like it's kind of an exodus of excellent cows and older, you know, 80,000 kilo cows. It's thanks, girls, but you've done your job, and it's time for the next generation to kind of step in here, because I can't get over selling a heifer that's going to go out and make me, gross me $10,000 as a two-year-old and let her go to the neighbor for $3,000 even. Like, there's just no value in that to me. I would sooner just focus on my own. And the beef market where we are, we're 20-1 for beef cows to dairy cows in Saskatchewan. So it changes the dynamic of things a little bit out our way as well, just because of that aspect.
I think we're like you, Nick, that we want to raise every calf that drops. We want to make sure she's the chosen one and raise them, because we did the initial cull. We culled off the bottom, but now I don't want to sell heifers because I put a lot of investment before they hit the ground. And then you feed them free choice milk. Those heifers cost a lot of money. So we're losing if we sell heifers. So if she's not bred by beef and she's a heifer, she's staying.
Yeah, we had, like I told you guys last night, you have a kid with the 4-H project and they want to come and they're like, yeah, I like that heifer. And we're like, yeah, I do too. She's still here. And after all the rigorous, you know, the rigorous tests you put through your cows and you get that heifer calf and you're like, man, like 4,000 or 5,000, that's not enough. Right. Yeah. And like you said too, I think, you know, people may be at a touch of the replacement costs, that it takes to get to heifer to the milking string. Like, gone are the days of $2,500 to get a heifer to the milking string. Right. We're talking more like $3,500.
I think I heard a high of 4 today. That's maybe too high, but that's 4.
Yeah.
It's 4 in British Columbia.
See? So, like, it's, I think that, you know, just goes to show the importance of, you know, picking the right ones to work with and using all the tools in your tool bag to make sure that, yeah, you're getting those right calves in the ground and limiting the health events and getting them rolling, right? So,
and maybe changing that conversation with the 4-H kids, be like, oh, you want a calf? Oh, you can have a calf next year, because all my heifers are spoken for.
Yeah, that's true. So, no.
So what is some new ways that you guys are using the predictions? Now that you know you can take better decisions, have you found a new management strategies to deploy that information? So, like, the obvious one for me would be embryo transfer. How are you selecting your recips? Are you just, who's got a CL, I'm sticking an embryo in? Or?
No, actually, when we did all those genomic testing and we did a lot of fleshing, we looked at calving ability. And honestly, those embryos didn't go in, those poor calving abilities. There was no way I'm going to waste hundreds of dollars in one that's not going to come out the back. I mean, I could cut it out the side, it's no problem, but it's still an issue. I didn't want to take them out the side, so.
I'm the exact opposite. Mine's, if I'm not excited about her, she qualifies to be a recipient. If she had a good heat, it's going in.
Jersey. Doesn't matter if her daughter, if the daughter fertility on that recip is 90 or anything like that, you don't.
Nah, environment still plays more, yep. I think, to nutrition. Factor what your nutrition level's sitting at. Did she have a good heat with a really good CL, right time of year, everything like that plays into it a little bit more. It's just kind of, a bit of a.
Is that what you're referring to, Tony? Like, do you see that at your level? Effect. Like, yeah, for us, you know, people talk about, people have said I only put embryos in, you know, calves that are themselves genomic tested for over $100 fertility.
Yeah, definitely. Like, calving ease is important. Like, why stick an embryo in her if she's going to have to pull it? Like, that's a pain. But daughter fertility, it's becoming more and more important. We've seen some folks with our proprietary traits at Zoetis for twinning and abortions. They'll blend that in as well. So if she's in our system, a low STA for abortion, she's not going to get an embryo because they don't want to risk it. But if she's a low STA for twins, they'll put an embryo in her. Because you can control the number of offspring, right?
I think the couple ways we combat that, when we do ET transfer, we have enough uteruses around that we can put everything in fresh. So right there, fresh, I think we had good luck with conception rates, putting fresh embryos in, and also we only flush with sex semen. So calving ease, typically a heifer is, you know, comes out a little easier than a bull too, so those are kind of the ways we've kind of combated that. But I haven't personally looked at daughter fertility on recips. So I guess
I've done a little bit of that. I personally, I know, like, a little bit different than Ian, I guess. I know fertility, it's not extremely heritable, but for me, especially since genomics has come on, I put a lot more stock in it. And for me, my belief is I think I see a bigger difference in our high and our low genomic animals for that trait than what we believe there is in the heritability. And so currently this past, I guess it's 7 or 8 months, we've been working with a stud where we're putting in genomic tested embryos. So the embryos that are going in, we know what they're at for LPI and their confirmation. And for instance, last batch of embryos I put in, I did go through and I pulled out my best heifer for daughter fertility. And I was like, her mother gets pregnant every time she's bred. And she was quite a bit above, like I said, she was above parent average. I think she's 106, parent average was 103 or something. And I put our best embryo in her and she's preg check tomorrow. So we'll find out. I think she's pregnant. She shows good heat, so I'm pretty sure she's pregnant.
Yeah, that fertility predictions are coming on. Like, it's easy to screw it up, as Ian pointed out, right? Like, you have to hit your bases when it comes to management. Go ahead.
If I was putting in an embryo that could be worth $100,000, I'd probably be looking at daughter fertility on the recip too.
Well, I guess another trait for me that I've been slowly looking more and more, I look at and I is the hoof health, and more I'll get a cow that I'm like, her feet are trouble all the time. Every time I'm hoof trimming, I have to get her in the chute. She's got strawberry, she's got white line, whatever. Always getting foot issues, and more I look it up, and sure enough, genomics, they're usually low. And I can't say I've necessarily looked at the top end as much, but it's my problem ones. I'm seeing definite correlation. And for me, with selecting bulls, I wouldn't say it's a yes or no difference on hoof health, but it's one of those, if it's a borderline bull, if I use them or not, hoof health might.
Got to check Porter out. Pretty good in hoof health.
Well, maybe
shameless plug.
Get back to
shameless plug from Jodi.
But you know what's even more important than hoof health? I look at body condition score too. I think those cows that shed off the pounds and they go down a couple body scores, well, they lose the fat pad in their foot, and I think it's related to hoof health. Yep. So if we can get cows that can milk and maintain body condition, without coupled with that feed efficiency, I think that's where the next money is going to be made.
My brother Lucas and I too, like, we see that with bulls. Like, no, we're not supposed to say names of bulls, but there's a specific bull that we see at every single one of them. It has terrible body condition, or body condition is low on every single daughter. And we had, you know, 7, 8, 9 daughters too. So it's, yeah.
So as a vet, I look at those herds when there's poor body condition, I have a hard time getting the conception rates up and preg rates. So we look at that and you go on CDN and look, oh, you've never even looked at body condition score and they're always in the negative. So we're trying to change that slowly, but it's years, right?
Yeah, I mean, to turn over the herd completely, probably looking at 5 to 7 years minimum, like, and that's if we start today. And of course, with a lot of the stuff, it's a combination of management and genetics. So management's easy. We can start to make changes relatively quick, like we would with a repro program. Let's say you're not getting great pregnancies. We'll do a sync protocol, if allowed. Change things up to get it working today. But then, to your point, Jodi, let's take a look at your strategies on bull selection. What are you putting in the tank, and how is that going to rear its head in 5 years?
Another thing with that body the body condition, I found it to be an interesting trait. And there's been times you see a bull that might be low mobility score, and you want to use them, and you're like, I don't know how much I trust that one yet. Do I? Don't I? But I do know I've never seen a crampy cow that's fat. It seems that way. So I always kind of like, if I'm unsure and I see body condition scores high, I'm like, oh, they'll be okay. They'll be mobile. And I don't know if I'm right or wrong, but I put some weight into that at least.
So you guys visit your compatriots' farms pretty often, right? You're going to go see your buddies' farms and day in and day out, or maybe not day in, day out, but pretty regularly, right?
Not very often in Saskatchewan, actually.
Ian's got one or two neighbors all together, so.
But can you tell the difference between a herd that's been genomically testing for a few years versus one that's maybe not, or is just getting started, just by looking at the cows?
I think it would depend how aggressive you go with what you do with the data. And like you alluded to right off the bat, like, too many guys, okay, I'm going to go and genomic test all my herd. And then what? Like, you need to go into it with a set plan. But with a set structured plan, yeah, I mean, we've all seen it, just talk within our own herds, how it's changed things. And to guys in Saskatchewan, like, we are the most commercial province, I would think, within the country. And so there's not too many guys that are just going full out and doing it. But like I said before, I think it will come to be a time where they will, because the growth has stalled and there's only one way you can keep getting more efficient with your milk production. It starts to come down in genetics.
It's kind of fun in those genomic herds. If they've done it and they've stuck by their strategy, then you get a really uniform group of cows. They all come in with rear udders and teat placement and just awesome feet and legs. Depends what they're selecting for, but you can kind of usually pick that out if they're aggressive with it.
Adam?
Well, I would say that most of the herds I go into at least do some genomic testing, so I can't really say that I notice anything different, because it's, I think most of them do.
What about you, Nick?
Well, just to on Ian's point too, like, usually the people that are genomic testing are the ones keen enough that have the management practices in place to do something with it, right? So, yeah, I would say the people that are doing it, but again, that's something that I haven't really paid attention to be quite honest. Yeah.
And Jodi hit it on the head, right? More uniform. The cows, like, the extremes they just go away. It takes a little bit of time, and you have to have the right strategy, as Ian said, but they just kind of melt off into the sunset. We don't have them anymore. Because when you use something like a selection index and you have better information, you can see it manifest in how the cows look. What about parents? I think a couple of you are still multi-generational farms, right? Right. I think, yeah. How have your parents reacted? I've got some stories, but I'd like to hear you guys, is like, what are their impressions once they see the impact of better genetic decisions?
Who wants to take that one first?
I'll go first. Okay. So I'm actually, I had farmed with my dad, and he passed away from ALS 5 years ago. But we started, so when we first started with genomics, I remember I did a lot of reading on it. And for me, it was kind of a hobby, following this genomic thing. And Dad and I talked about it, and we're like, this is ridiculous. As if they think this is going to be anything. And and for us, then we started doing some. And it was the when we really started buying it and believing in ourselves is when we tested siblings. and we saw that the you just went through their traits for type, production, everything, and you've seen the differences of what genomics said, and it separated them, and then it was kind of there that, okay, this genomics thing is not as stupid as we think, and then it's a good reason why we have to keep our minds open a little bit, I guess. Like right now, I don't know if I'm allowed to say this or not, but like I'm like the methane efficiency thing, and I just like roll my eyes, but maybe I better keep an open mind, right? Because some of these things, I thought this with genomics at the beginning, and then when we kind of got into the more elite genetics with on the genomics side of things, that was one thing I remember Dad saying to me. He really liked it and was he saw the value in it for sure. And he had an open mind towards that, but he told me, he goes, you just keep up with that. That's a young man's game. But no, he was on board as well.
Yeah, my parents have, I know, I've been pretty lucky and blessed to have a couple parents that have been, since I was a kid, just if I was passionate and wanted to go after something, to let me run with it. But, you know, if it was going to be a total waste of money, I would have noticed it firsthand, and I'm sure they would have backed me up to, like, yeah, we got to stop this. It's just not worth it. But no, just because of our area, my dad too, he's always, more beef was always something that he was happy for, just having the right amount of replacements. And so the more beef we can have, the more drop calves this time of year, like at home with all the commercial beef producers, you can get $500 cash money. CRA's not listening. for these calves, and you'll get it like that. And these beef guys, I mean, the calf could be worth $16,000, $18,000, $2,000 come fall time here now. So, yeah, it alluded to, or led to using more beef semen. So, my parents were on board with that one for sure.
And I was the same as Ian. Like when I came in to as a partner in the farm, my uncle did the breeding, and I just came in and he let me take everything over, let me do what I wanted with it. And then I, you know, talked to my dad when he was my business partner, and listen, I was thinking about buying this calf, and the numbers are really good, and yeah, the numbers this month maybe, he's like, yeah, the numbers change all the time though. How can you just pick off the numbers? And then I try to explain it to him and how genomics works, and I think he just kind of just throws up his hands, but he was always supportive of me, and like Ian, his parents let us do our thing, and you know, just our last proof round too, we've had a couple, like we've had our Renegades that have went, you know, very good, and our Lambdas, and all of a sudden, you know, look at the numbers that they indicated what they were going to do, look at the production that they're doing, look at their scores, look at what they're doing, you know, it's genomics being realized right there. And he's like, well, that's, you know, it's really cool how it all comes together, right? So yeah,
it's pretty easy to sell at home. Like I should say, my husband Mark should be the one up here talking, because he does all the herd manager and we farm together with the family. But it's going to be profitable, more money per stall in the end, and so that's what we did. And plus, when you're in a heifer surplus, it was a no-brainer for us.
Yeah, it's been interesting to see the feedback from some of the older generations, because there's some folks that have been very, very traditional, and like, whoa, you're telling me that this approach I've had for 30, 40 years is wrong? No. We're telling you, you can do better. We can help you make fewer mistakes.
Now, some of their approaches are wrong. The real school ones, they get they're not in business anymore, though, either. Like, you're going to have to look at it as being progressive and finding more unique ways to turn a profit on farm, because the traditional ways of doing it just aren't going to cut it anymore.
The best example I have, to your point about, like, the traditional ways weren't cutting it, there's this old producer, he's been retired. His daughter and her cousins had taken over the farm. And we're sitting there kind of going through, showing him how well the predictions align with performance. Like, look, this is how much milk you're getting per point of genetic prediction. This is how long the cows are lasting. And he just sat there, started shaking his head. And he's engaged, very, very positive, but he starts shaking his head. I'm like, is everything okay? Like, I'm just thinking of all the hours that we spent trying to nurse these broken cows through transition, and there was nothing we could do because they didn't have the right DNA, and it was just blood, sweat, and tears for years. And so that type of like light bulb moment for the older generation has been really, really good to see, because, you know, there's not going to be more dairy farmers moving forward, right? I mean, the industry continues to shrink, and so what we have is probably what we have, and we're going to have to make do. And so that's why I think the technology has a lot of promise for the next generation.
Just like registrations and genomic testing, when HCD, the haplotype for cholesterol deficiency, people would wean their calves and they would slowly waste away and pass away, but it was genetic. It was nothing you could do. Everyone would throw the book at them, but if you would just have a genetic test at the beginning, you would kind of have a good idea what's going on in the herd.
Yeah, and unfortunately, it's after the fact, right? We can't predict necessarily on those lethals what's going to happen, but once we get enough information, he's like, oh, yeah, that piece of DNA, that was a little important. Maybe we should not select for that or select against that in some instances.
Yeah, it always seems there's, well, like your methane index or whatever is coming about. That's all, you know, they're going to find different unique traits that are going to be of value to us down the road. I mean, but at the end of the day, it's going to come back to milk production. Like Nick was saying, it wasn't that long ago. You know, if you were getting 1.5 kilos of butterfat per cow per day on your herd, you were pumped. Like, yeah, these cows are cranking it out. Well, if you're hitting that now, you're sorely disappointed. Like, what's going on here? And it, you know, two is kind of going
to
be the
blame the nutritionist.
Yeah,
you're calling. You're,
but yeah, like. 2 is kind of the gold standard here now, and it won't be too long before 2.5 kilos per cow per day is probably going to be the new gold standard. And there's only so many things you can do to control your environment to be able to get them there. And ultimately, it's going to be your genetics that'll be holding you back from it.
So recognizing that we're a talkative bunch, and we're getting closer to the end, not quite to the end yet, but I think I'd like to close this out with a twofold question, right? If you had to restart your genomics program, right, go back in time, but you got to retain all the knowledge that you've had over the last 5-6 years, what would you do different at the start of using Clarified? And then where do you see the industry going or breeding in general going in the next 10, 20 years?
First part, the question, I would have been more aggressive on those outliers, like the heifers that first popped up and they stood out above the rest. Rather than just using a little bit of a sex semen, I probably would have been a little more aggressive on the embryo transfer of the ones that really truly stood out, like from whether they were other flesh mates on their own or just from their herd mates. I think if I would have worked with those a little bit harder right off the bat, I'd probably be in a little bit better position than I am.
For the future, I guess one thing for me that I don't know if I have the answer for this yet because I'm still kind of new in the robot barn, I think, at least. And but one thing I'm seeing is I think that we can draw our lactations out a lot longer than we currently do. And I know, I guess going forward, when there's all these things we do, there's a lot of traits. We're just going to get more and more traits. And I look at it and I think, what makes me a happy dairy farmer? And whatever makes me a happy dairy farmer, it's those kind of cows I should have. And it's cows that are put together well. And I like pretty cows and cows that don't give me any trouble. And you know, we can do a lot of things. And obviously, I select for more than just that. But if we can make correct cows that have few health problems, so high fertility, low somatic cell, and then I would also throw that hoof health in there as well. If we have those things, I'm going to be a happy dairy farmer, and there's going to be cows that last long, and they're going to be profitable. So that would be one way I see it that I think more and more, I try to put that in my head and remind myself that when I'm picking bulls, those are the things that I think are really important. Obviously, we like the production too, but I like to just be a happy dairy farmer. And then going back to that with the lactations, it's something that I've put this out there to a few people since I've been in the robots, is I'd really like to see data and some traits added into our breeding decisions on robot visits. I think we can look at lactation persistency, but in a barn like ours, it's going to be different than a tie stall. It's going to be different than a parlor. And what drives persistency in our barn is cows that go to the robot regularly still when they're 250, 300 days in milk. And I guess a cow that I have in my place and the reason that she is in this position is because she is infertile. So I'll be straightforward, but she's a cow that currently right now she's in second lactation and she's hitting 50,000 lifetime. And I look at it and I just think to myself, if I had more cows like that, I wouldn't have to worry about beef semen because I'd be having less calvings. She doesn't cause me trouble. First lactation, she milked around 700 days in her first lactation. In the second 300 days, she milked about 300 or 400 kilos less than her first 365, and she had higher components. And I look at it, and now to be fair, it was when we moved from tie stall to the freestall. So that helped her out, to be fair. But I just look at it, and I look at a cow like that, and I think there's got to be a little more to this, and some of these cows can do it. They can just keep going, and why bother calving them so regularly? But I want to see some of those traits, like robot visits.
To your point on persistency, it's something I'd like to keep striving more towards, too, because just to your point, like the most profitable cows on the farm are the ones that can hit a peak lactation and hold it and doing it without any kind of problems. Like it takes so much just to get a cow to that point, to hitting that 65, 70 kilos, that if they are rolling through that, let them keep going. The guys that, it's usually a AI rep or something like that, that's always pushing your, let's get these first breeding services down, your 50 days in milk or whatever it may be. And sure, you can get them in a calf, but I've yet to have a single industry person that would push the early breeding zone. Tell me what it costs to calve a cow. And it's a number I've asked to multiple people, and no one has ever been able to give me the answer of what it costs. Everything that's factored into her, from your opportunity cost of just letting her roll with a long lactation to deciding to breed her, vet checks, dry off, close-up ration, mortality, anything that goes along with that would be factored into a cost, and no one's ever been able to give me a number for it. So I've always seen it, just like you were saying, Adam, like if that cow is rocking and rolling, like just let her go. And that cow is going to, if she can hold that 60 kgs for 300 days, well, why do you want to breed her back in the first place and just put her through all that stress again?
How old are the 305s? 305s were a time when our cows averaged 8,000 kilos. Maybe it was fair enough for a 305, but we could technically challenge it. We're not going to get into this can of worms right now, but but honestly, it's a thing. Like, that's it. So talking to your question, is what do I want to see? Well, one, I would have trusted the outliers more. For the same as Ian said, I would have maybe been more harsh on the bottom, like, oh, and they look good, but they never panned out, and work a lot more with the top ones and use recipients. And I really like to see, I think a good number we should be focusing more is on average daily lifetime production. Because in that number, it might be a bit old if there's lag, but you have everything in there. You have like milk production, persistency, want to go see the robot, feet, legs, repro. You have everything in there. So as a herd, and we shouldn't be talking about rolling herd average, we should talk about average lifetime production, like daily, or that cow's daily lactation. So.
Yeah, those are terrific points, guys. Like, I know there's farms that are challenging that mantra already. And you know, when you calve a cow in, it's a risk, right? You know, you could be the best, you could transition cows the best in the whole world, but still, there is a risk that something's gonna go wrong. And if you eliminate a lactation over three or four, right? And yeah, since we've increased in production, we've moved out our voluntary weighting, right, out from 60 to 80 in our heifers, it's 100. And then, you know, you get some silly metrics that are out there in the world that they hold us by, you know, percentage of cows pregnant by, you know, this is a vet, Jody knows where I'm probably going with this, but yeah, like let these cows go. You have a cow at, you know, 70 kgs at 80 days. What are you going to do? Should you just let her roll? Is she going to get, you know, do you trust, you know, you have a 25 to 30% conception rate. Let that cow roll, let her do her thing. And it definitely would be, you know, what can we see that's out there? I know people are challenging it. How can we put some numbers and some monetary numbers to that mantra? And that would be that'd be an excellent thing to.
One of the arguments I've heard to the longer lactations is we're going to, I forget how it was phrased, but more or less brought up that, yeah, but we're going to end up with cows that are fat and start getting issues. And I think, well, then that's our problem. We need to fix that. Right, because if they can keep going, let them go. And if we're finding they're getting too heavy, and we're getting some health issues down the road because they are too heavy calving the next time, if it's 2.5 years later or whatever, well, let's fix that and let's get our ration better for that. Then I think that's a better solution than just not calving them longer. If they're
put in condition on like that, are they really milking that much? I mean, any of the ones that we've ever had that have been the high persistent, they keep running. They keep a nice cover to them maybe once they hit the 100-day mark, but they put everything into their milk, and they just don't seem to put any weight on until you finally do breed them back. And then, yeah, they slow down a little bit quicker and do get their weight on them. But any of my experiences anyways, that would be the least of their worries, is usually try to keep weight on those ones that are trying to milk too hard.
Yeah, I don't think it's a good excuse.
Yeah, and that's a pretty consistent request, right? It's like, how can we find those cows that they'll hit peak and hold it? And hold it, and hold it, and hold it, and just keep doing their job. And yeah, that calving's stressful. Like, it's stressful regardless of the species, and if we can reduce that stress, I think it's a great thing. I think it's that going to come back to the economics. Is like, what does it pay off? Is this what's economically right for the operation? And like, welfare-wise, is that what's right for the cow? I think some of the old mantras that we all grew up with, right? 305-day, that's some old data. As a physiologist, right? Some of the work coming out of Wisconsin, she needs 60 days to involute that uterus. I don't think that's necessarily true anymore. Like, they're probably ready to go at 30 days. Those ovaries are ovulating. The uterus looks good. We could probably bring them back if we wanted to. The question is it right, what's right for the cow? And is it make sense economically?
And yeah, and drying cows off, like you guys probably, you know, drying cows off when you have, if you breed them early, it's a challenge, right? Challenge to dry a cow down from, you know, she's 40 liters, needs to go dry, okay? Get her down there and dry her off properly and get her turned and ready to go the next round, so, yeah.
Yeah, I think those extended lactations, they make a lot of sense on those DNBs, right? She's a cow that, for some reason, maybe she just has a bad temperament, you don't really like her attitude, declare DNB at freshening, and you're just going to milk her as long as she can justify her spot. And then, as Ian highlighted, I got a replacement heifer that will push her out when it's time. Thank you for your service. Great. I really appreciate what you've done for the farm. But
well, that's huge. If you can get that extra, whether it be $1,200 to $1,800 for your cull cows, I mean, when you look at your grand scheme of your spreadsheet with the count at the end of the year, actually going back to my father-in-law, you said, another thing he said too, he's like, yeah, when I look at all my costs coming in and going out, our profit at the end of the year a lot of times comes down to my cull cows and bull calf sales, and that's what your actual profit's sitting at. So the more cull cows you can make sure you're shipping out the door in good condition and good working order to get your full value for them, you add it up over a course of a year, and it actually does make you quite a bit more money coming out.
Pretty wide-ranging discussion. Maybe not as wide-ranging as last night, but we don't have pints in front of us either, so I think we were a little bit better behaved, potentially. Less hockey talk, for sure. Something I'm not very well-versed in, so I appreciate that. Any closing thoughts for folks today? Things that you wish that they walk away with, especially when it comes to like the portfolio services from HOCAN, from registration to classification and genomic testing? Like, anything you take home messages from your respective farms?
I think, you know, it's already been said, but like, just have a plan, have your goals. You know, like our goal is 2% and to maintain, 2 kgs of fat. We're working towards that goal. That's our goal. So what is our game plan of getting to that goal? And through our, you know, through our careful sire selection and, you know, spreading the risks of our genomic bulls that we use, and you know, making sure, you know, meticulous sire selection and using our index that we use, I think that we're on our way there, right? So that's, we've seen the progress. Stay the course, have the protocols in place, and yeah, know what you're going to do with that genetic information, and have that genetic information suited for your goals. So
take action, right? Take action.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree 100%. I mean, that, and I agree, in genomic testing and classification kind of keeps you on track. Like, you get in certain stable blindness, like, oh, that King Boy is my favorite cow. Well, actually, she probably shouldn't be. But so you have somebody in, look at your herd objectively, see if it lines up with your goals and as you're going, and plus all the milk component factors too. But yeah, we're the same. Be goal-driven.
Yeah, I don't think I have anything really to add. I think we've covered it, and you guys have covered it as well. But I guess the one extra thing I'd say is just do what works for you. And I guess in breed cows, to me, it comes down to breeding cows like what you like, because be a happy dairy farmer and have the kind of cows that you like. So when you go in for breakfast, you're in a good mood because you didn't have problems, you didn't have mastitis case. That's what makes me a happy dairy farmer. So it's kind of what I like to select for.
I guess mine would be we're in a data-driven world, and it's going to be more and more so. And when you're looking at making the investment towards any of the services, be it the genomic testing, classification, milk recording, it's got to come back to return on investment. And the better farmers are going to be the ones that are really going to capitalize on their genetic side of things. And yeah, it's just a data-driven world. You wouldn't put a crop in the ground without having a soil sample and knowing what fertilizer you're going to be putting down. Every square inch of land is worth so much. You need to get the best crop you can off of that land. It's no different than raising your replacements. And with all the data now, like, who knows? Hell, maybe in 5 years I'm asking Siri and ChatGTP what I want to breed my cow to, and they can run her all through, and it'll spit out a mating for me. And I mean, you don't know what's coming down, but it's going to be data-driven, and you might as well start now, because I think it's just one of those things you're going to be left in the dust if you don't.
Yeah, I think every single point you guys have raised today, either here at the end or over the course of the last hour and a half, has been spot on. Like, having a plan, taking action, using the information has been key to your success. And it's not just clarified results, right? It's the entirety of the data that you have on farm, be it classification results or registration, that's been impactful for your operations. I think we'll take a page out of the podcaster's book and see if we can invite some participation from the audience. Any questions that you guys would like to ask of our excellent panelists today? You know, maybe something that we missed. Yeah, I mean, try to rephrase the question. So the delay of first breeding based off of body condition of the animal? Those animals that are able to maintain peak lactation for a prolactin, yeah. I'll defer to our experts here. I think that's who you really want to hear from.
Not strictly off of body condition, I wouldn't say. It's just a look at where they're at persistency-wise. Like, once... You know, if they're over 60 kilos, I tend not to breed a cow back. I mean, unless they're getting up into 200, 250 days of milk, then it's okay. It's time. Every couple of years is kind of the gold standard for the absolute best cows that we've ever had on farm. Ironically, those were the 95-point score cows, too, that they just worked their tails off. And, yeah, I usually didn't even look at them to that point. And part of it would play into body condition. Usually you won't even see, like, a lot of those cows, when they're super persistent and milk that hard, they kind of go quiet for quite a while a lot of times. Like, you'll maybe see an early heat on them. That was your chance to get them into calf. And then quite often I won't see a heat on them for 100 days maybe. So if they've been really persistent milk hard and they're at that 200-day milk mark in milk and they show a good sign of heat, then maybe they'll, okay, it's time to breed you. But usually by 200 days, if she doesn't have any condition on her, chances are persistency is not there. There could be something else wrong going on too. It's hard to say. Each cow is individual now, but we can identify them very easily from the data that we have now, whether you're robot or using your dairy comp or whatever. It's so easy to set your voluntary wait period to where you want it to be based off of production.
Are you talking about her genomic score as you breed her for the first time back, or as you breed her for the first time, or what is that what you're referring to, the genomic score that they have after?
Yeah, I would take into consideration a little bit body score. I think more so where production's at would be the heaviest, but I think body score would have a small impact.
Well, as a vet, they don't have the best conception rate when you're going to breed a cow and if she's a negative energy balance or if she's skinny, right? So, yeah, if it's best to wait maybe a cycle, let her get a few more pounds on her back, then probably the best choice for you.
Excellent question. Excellent. Any other questions from the audience? No? All right. Well, and to close, I will heap praise on the four of you. You guys are an excellent testament to how to use genomic results and how to incorporate into your operations. So you guys are doing an awesome job, and I honestly would have a hard time finding an opportunity for improvement in your plants today. So great job, folks, and looking forward to seeing the rest of the expo with you.
Thanks,
guys.
Just ask the panel guests to stay seated for a moment. Gert and I are just going to slide in here. So So just on behalf of Diamond V Dairy Classroom and CDX, we'd like to hand you a gift, a token of our appreciation. Ian from Benbie Holsteins in Saskatchewan, Adam Zehr from Walnutlawn Farms, in Ontario, Dr. Jodi Wallace, thank you so much. Nick, thank you so much. And of course, Dr. Anthony McNeel, thank you so very much for moderating the panel. Thank you, everyone. Have a great afternoon.